And thank you for inviting me back to Paulet St. Clair's. It's a great institution. Edmund mentioned Glasgow. When I was growing up there, my father would often, I'd find him doing things where he tried to fit in with local customs, but especially he would try to speak the local language. And I found this very embarrassing. Chaudhry Sher Mubarak looks at the lock. Light shakes out the dish rice dye and scatters the water with sequins. Look, hen, says my father. Loch Lomond, as if it were all his doing, as if he owned it. Laird of Lomond, laird of the language. He's proud to say hen, and even more loch, with an och, not an och, to speak proper Glaswegian like a true-born Scot, because he makes the right sound at the back of the throat. He can say hush and hwab and kamosh, because the sounds for happy and dream are the words that swim in the water for him. So he says it again, hen, look, the loch. Quite a few of the poems in my new book, Luck is the Book, depend on chance events that come together. And this one I'll read is about a kind of a miracle that happened because of a trick of the weather. The elephant is walking on the River Thames. The whole city has come out to see the river frozen over, solid enough to light a blazing fire and spit roast an ox, a suckling pig, sparks in the air, fat hissing on silver, mutton pies sizzling. Red-nosed boys slide past in halls, horses pull sledges of coal under the bridge, and then this. An elephant steps carefully onto the ice. The known world cracks. Reality lumbers over the edge. Hawkers freeze, pour ale into mid-air. As the creature sails by, more graceful than any stilt walker or skater. Later, they will recall it, like something suspended in time, like first love at the last frost fair. They will say, that was the day. I was there. And a little addition to that poem, First Sight Through Falling Snow. The elephant looks at the cathedral. It looks back. Their hearts tangle. Out of line. Happy arrives with the moon on its shoulder, glamorous. You can tell it has crossed the line by the way it moves, eyes littering like wet roads in headlights, dangerous and out of control, attention all over the place. It loves the language and talks to strangers, asks your name, looks in your face and offers its hand. No sign of a knife or a gun, no respect for the rules, not a trace of shame. Before you can stop it, Happy slaps your back and kisses your wife on the cheek. This is no place for Happy. It leads to touching. It could spread an infection, cause a contagion of glances with that dirty laugh, wine on the breath. It encourages smiling and unrestricted movement of hands and feet. Happy is just asking to be buried up to its neck in the sand, a face like that, asking to be stoned to death. Is Happy known to you? Tell Happy this for its own good, to hide its ankles, cover its wrists. I think I'll read you a ghost story now. And I have to say that the ghost isn't anyone I actually knew. A haunting. That was where I saw you first, on the last step of the well, wet from bathing. Drops of water fell in an arc from your hair, down your back, trickling into the cloth tied tight at your hips. My lips went dry. My thirst began there and never stopped. Did you feel how I watched and willed you to turn? How I waited on the steps day after day for you to pass, for the light on your body, the sight of you sliding into the water, into my heart. My heart hidden, I learned the art of making you up in my image, making something of nothing, like someone drunk and staggering from looking at a wine glass, the wine forbidden. But I could swear you lifted your head for the scent of blossoms in my hair. Kneeling at the brink, I felt you near and wondered if you would dare speak. You left. Your eyes were elsewhere. You must have heard when I went the hiss of scandal. You must have asked if I was pushed or missed a step or went willingly over the edge. You must have wondered what I felt when I fell. I sank and sank in the bottomless well, like falling into a night with no stars, down the shaft of black, the finger that points out the route to hell. Not alone, not the first. We are too many to count, too drowned to tell all the lost girls. Gone from the fields of sugarcane that stroked our waists and spoke sweet words, from the houses that held us too tight and whispered behind our backs, to this open mouth with its dangerous breath. You never came back to the step where I lie in wait, but other boys do, wrapping wet cloth around their waists, laughing with their heads thrown back, teeth white in the dark, the ones who could have been you. I reach out to stroke that lovely dip they have between haunch and hip, the silk of their skin that should have been yours, and feel them recoil, shivering, as if they'd been touched by knowing too much, by death. When I send a token, my garland of jasmine, and a wisp of my hair, they pull back, aghast at the ring of white afloat on black, as if they can smell, braided into the scent of desire, the stench of loss, as if they have felt the caress of a ghost. When my husband Simon Power died, there was a dream that I was trying to write for a very long time. And somehow, in spite of trying for a couple of years, it never worked in a poem. And it was only when I came to write a sonnet that somehow the dream appeared again and found a way into the poem. And there was something about, I think, the formality of the form that allowed this dream, this poem to be written. The trick. In a wasted time, it's only when I sleep that all my senses come awake. In the wake of you, let day not break. Let me keep the scent, the weight, the bright of you. Take the countless hours and count them all night through, till that time comes when you come to the door of dreams, carrying oranges that cast a glow up into your face. Greedy for more than the gift of seeing you, I lean in to taste the color, kiss it off your offered mouth. For this, I fall asleep in haste, willing to fall for the trick that tells the truth, that even your shade makes darkest absence bright, that shadows live wherever there is light. Not long ago I fell in love with an app. I don't know if that's ever happened to you, but there are some apps that are just wonderful. And this one, you'll see which one it is in the poem. Flight Radar. From the top of the Shard, the view unfolds down the Thames to the sea. The city laid by a trick of sight, vertically in front of me. At London Bridge Station, trains slide in and out in a long, slow dance. It is not by chance that I am here, not looking down, but up to where you are on flight 199, coming in to land. I have learned to track you on my mobile phone. However far you go, I have the app that uses the radar to trace your path. There you are now, circling down around the spire where I stand, my face reflected over your pulse in the glass. You cannot see. You have no radar for me, no app to make you look back or down to where I'm lifting my hand. Darling, I will track your flight till it is a dot that turns and banks and falls out of sight, looking into the space where you were. Fingers frozen on the tiny keys, I will stay where I am in the dying light, the screen still lying in my palm. And this last longer one I read you is called This Tide of Hunger. If you come to the edge of the world, you need to be ready to throw away the part of your ticket that says return, along with the plans you made and the life you once had. They will say you went somewhere, who knows where, and stayed. If you have strayed to this end of the world, it's not because you have been here before or come back to the door of a lover. You never sat here together, never sipped wine or held hands on that bench or kissed by this river. You have no history without this tide of hunger. But you know the vast reef of the sky, the scavenger's hunger, its insatiable cry. If you've come to write the hurt out of your heart, to take the ache and heal it with words, leave now. No scrabbling in dead poets' bins can turn gone into come or become. Come with a stranger's heart, wiped clean, to a city that hangs on the sea by a hook, holds on hard to the edge of luck, and luck could be just a fingernail, or a sail, or a hook, the swish of turbines turning in rain, its hiss on pavements, its shimmer dropped like a plumb line down through layers underground, the slip of mud, the slap of the sea. If you come here, you see that the mud is a person washed up on the shore, a body smoothed and shaped, stroked from calf to thigh to nape. The giver and taker make themselves up out of each other. Water fingers linger in the deepest folds, limbs open and close back into the river, an arm or a leg or a hip heave out from under the sheet. The lifted mud is only a hint of the lost land beneath, between the shorelines that yearn for each other. Water and mud and water, intricate lovers. You stand here and hope that a hand will lift out of a wave, wave to you from that weather-drowned land. Even your stranger's feet remember pacing the ground under the water, the tracks of women and men crossing, crisscrossing, after ice and drought, through storm and calm, hunting the sun and rain, scents on the wind. You were never looking for ghosts, but they find you here. Voices sing through the tide. The rustling, the breathing, the music of travelers takes you out where the land would have been. Walked over, washed away, rolled in. It holds your stranger's body, folds it in arms of mud, and the gulls walk over your heart, over and over on hieroglyph feet, their tracks a brain of messages delivered from half-built edges. The water seeps over the drowned land to the lip of the city. It holds its breath. Between the widowed face of the sky and the ringed eye of a gull, everything changes scale. A blade of grass is a turbine wave that lifts to the light as a fish gleams under the blade of an oar, like a shoulder blade kissed by the moon. And the land wears the water like a shining veil, and the water bears the moon like a sacred jewel. And the heart is a fish, and luck is the hook that flicks it up between water and land, between Humber and Hull, and holds it there at the edge of the world.